Good afternoon to all of you. My screen is visible to you.
Yes, sir, it's quite clear.
Thank you. Thank you. Today we are going to explore a synthetic aperture radar remote sensing. Synthetic aperture radar remote sensing is basically a microwave remote sensing technique, and this has been widely used for information retrieval. If you will see synthetic aperture radar remote sensing technique, so there are different possibilities to do the technique with the help of airborne remote airborne platform, spaceborne platform, as well as from the ground based platform also it is possible to do the imaging. Now if you will see the microwave remote sensing technique, so microwave remote sensing technique is basically a remote sensing technique which is carried in the microwave region of electromagnetic spectrum. Now the microwave region of electromagnetic spectrum covers 1 millimeter to 100 centimeter. When we are talking about a remote sensing, so just a few lines of discussion related to remote sensing. So remote sensing is a technique in which a sensor is collecting the information of any object without touching the object or without going in touch with the object. Now when the sensor is not going to touch the object physically, so here electromagnetic waves are used to retrieve the information of the object. The information may be related to the physical property, geometric property, electric property. It depends on the type of sensor which is used to acquire the information. Now when we are talking about remote sensing, so there are different remote sensing techniques. So one remote sensing which has been widely used, that is the optical multispectral remote sensing technique. And then optical multispectral, there are other techniques like thermal remote sensing technique, then lidar remote sensing technique, hyperspectral remote sensing technique, and microwave remote sensing technique. Now if you see the optical multispectral remote sensing technique, so basically that remote sensing is passive remote sensing technique, and the synthetic aperture radar remote sensing is a kind of active imaging microwave remote sensing technique. So as it has the name active imaging microwave remote sensing technique, it means that the sensor here, basically radar sensors are used, so radar sensor is going to acquire the images for the area which will be imaged, and here radar sensors are mainly operated here from 1 millimeter to 100 centimeter wavelength range of electromagnetic spectrum. If you will see the electromagnetic radiation, because here we are going to use the electromagnetic waves which will be generated from the SAR sensors, and those electromagnetic waves will interact with the earth object, and finally the information will be gathered. So few slides are related to the basic concept, then we will go in details of synthetic aperture radar. So here electromagnetic waves are transmitted by synthetic aperture radar sensors. So from the name it is clear, electromagnetic, it means that there will be two field vectors. One will be electric field vector and another will be the magnetic field vector. Both will be perpendicular to each other and mutually perpendicular to the direction of propagation of electromagnetic wave. Here C is representing direction of propagation of electromagnetic wave, and E is representing direction of electric field vector, and M is representing the direction of vibration of magnetic field vector. Now this is a very fundamental rule. Most of you are already aware with this relation between wavelength and frequency. The wavelength is the length of one wave cycle, which can be measured as the distance between successive wave crests. So here you can see lambda represented by lambda is represented as wavelength, and the relation between wavelength and frequency is when the wavelength will be multiplied with frequency, so it is going to give you the speed of light. And here we are going to talk about the speed of light or speed of electromagnetic wave, both will be same here. So the relation shows that when there will be increase in wavelength, it means that there will be decrease in frequency, and when there will be increase in frequency, there will be decrease in wavelength. Because here in the SAR remote sensing, we are going to use the different frequency ranges to do the imaging of the earth surface or earth feature. And we are talking about the microwave region of electromagnetic spectrum. of 1 millimeter to 100 centimeter. So here one can see the microwave band. Again, it is categorized in several category between 1 millimeter to 100 centimeter. If you will see, it is starting from K band. So K band is again subdivided in three category: Ka, K, and Ku band. And if you will see, after K band there is X band, and X band will have the wavelength range 2.4 centimeter to 3.7 centimeter. C band will have 3.75 to 7.5 centimeter. S band will have 7.5 to 15 centimeter, and L band will have 15 to 30 centimeter, and finally P band will have 30 to 100 centimeter. So what we are observing here, when we are moving from K band to P band, there is increase in wavelength, but there is decrease in frequency. Now, for different applications, these wavelength ranges are used, because when we are talking about optical multispectral data set, so from the name it is clear, multispectral means if there are multiple spectra, it means that multiple frequency will be there. So in optical multispectral data set, one can easily get multi-frequency data set from one sensor. But here in the case of synthetic aperture radar remote sensing, if the microwave sensor or the radar sensor is designed for one particular wavelength, either that wavelength range is C band or S band or L band or P band, so for its entire time duration or for its entire lifetime, it is going to provide you the data set in one frequency range only. Suppose it is designed for C band with mean wavelength range 5.4 centimeter. So for its entire time period, it will be providing the data set in C band with 5.4 centimeter only. If one will require the data set in another frequency range, then they will have to order the data set of any other sensor, because in different frequency ranges, in all the most of the frequency ranges, we have the different sensors with their different characteristics. And one may think that what is the requirement of different frequency ranges. Actually, when we are increasing the wavelength, it means that when we are moving from K band to P band, for longer the wavelength, higher the penetration capability. Suppose anyone is interested to do the mapping and monitoring below forest cover, or if one is interested to do the subsurface mapping and monitoring, at that time that person or researcher will require the long wavelength data set like P band and L band. Unfortunately, we do not have any sensor in P band, but we have the sensor in L band, and European Space Agency, it has the future plan to launch a mission, that is the biomass mission, that will be providing the data set in P band. We will have a discussion on that also, like a discussion of few lines. Now, when we are talking about synthetic aperture radar, so synthetic aperture radar, its short name is SAR, S-A-R, is a form of radar that is used to create images of objects such as landscapes. These images can be either two or three dimensional representations of the object. Currently, all the sensors are providing two-dimensional image of the data set, but with the help of multiple stacks or multiple sets of the two-dimensional data set, one will be able to create the 3D representation of the object also. As we are knowing that the remote sensing which is carried in the microwave region of electromagnetic spectrum is known as the microwave remote sensing. Now, when we are talking about microwave remote sensing, so microwave remote sensing is again categorized in different category like passive remote sensing and active remote sensing. So the passive remote sensor sensing technique is basically acquiring the data set, acquiring the information from the radiated electromagnetic wave from the earth surface. So the imaging is done. Now when we are going to talk about active microwave remote sensing, so in active microwave remote sensing technique, again it is categorized in two category: imaging and non-imaging. So synthetic aperture radar is an imaging active microwave remote sensing technique which provides high spatial resolution data set, and with the help of this data set, one will be able to find the information of the earth objects. So this remote sensing has been successfully used not only for the earth object but also for the planetary bodies also. Like if you will see recently Chandrayaan 2 mission was launched. So in Chandrayaan 2 mission, it was the it is the first mission which will be providing the data set in two frequencies and in fully polarimetric mode. So it is the first sensor in the world which is going to provide the data set, or which is providing the data set in fully polarimetric mode for the lunar surface in 12 frequency mode. And if you will see, so synthetic aperture radar, so here this is a representation taken from the book of Lee and Portier. So in this image, one is able to see that synthetic aperture radar sensor is moving in one direction, and it is capturing the information of the earth object. And it is clear that nadir line is represented by here dotted points. So SAR sensors are not nadir looking sensors. Nadir looking means the nadir direction is the vertical direction. They are transmitting the electromagnetic pulses in the side looking in the side direction. They are not going to transmit the electromagnetic pulses in the vertical direction. The SAR sensors are side looking imaging radars, and they are providing the information of the object. Why? Because if the SAR sensor will be side looking, so it will have the complete information of the object. Because what is happening here, SAR sensor will transmit the electromagnetic pulses from the platform, and the electromagnetic pulse will propagate it through space and atmosphere, and it will interact with the earth object. And during interaction, scattering will take place. And when the scattering will take place, the incident electromagnetic wave, which was transmitted by the SAR sensor, will scatter in all the possible direction. But some information of the electromagnetic wave will come back towards the sensor. So the information which will be received by the sensor for the object will be used to generate images. This is a comparison between LIDAR, optical multispectral, and SAR. So when we are talking about the platform, so like most of the imaging with the help of LIDAR sensors is done with the help airborne technique. But when we are talking about optical multispectral, so airborne and spaceborne, both the platforms could be used to acquire the data set. But if you will see ISAT-2 was launched last year. And JIDAI data, JIDAI is basically a LIDAR sensor which is placed on International Space Station, and it is acquiring the data set from there. So currently we have the two sensors which are providing the LIDAR data from spaceborne mode, in spaceborne mode. Now when we are going to talk about the radiation, so LIDAR and SAR both are the example of active remote sensing technique. So both will have their own electromagnetic radiation, and that electromagnetic radiation will be transmitted towards the earth surface. And optical multispectral is kind of a passive sensor, and the sensor is acquiring the reflected sunlight from the earth surface, and the imaging is done. Now when we are talking about the spectrum, here in the case of LIDAR and optical multispectral, infrared and visual infrared is used. But in the case of synthetic aperture radar, microwave region of electromagnetic spectrum is used to do imaging. When we are talking about the frequency, so LIDAR is going to provide the single frequency data set. Optical multispectral will provide the data set in multi-frequency mode, means multiple frequencies will be there in the one data set. Again, when we are coming to the SAR sensor, so SAR sensor can provide the multi-frequency data set if the multiple sensors will be used, because one SAR sensor is going to provide the data set in one frequency range. Now here there are the two major advantages of synthetic aperture radar remote sensing, and those advantages are use of polarimetric technique and interferometric technique. And in the laboratory, the experiment of polarization and polarimetry, as well as the interference and interferometry, we have done in our lab during our graduation, masters, as well as intermediate also. this practical we have done, because the theories were mainly developed with the help of optical remote sensing technique, or not optical remote sensing, or we can say that optics only. But due to short wavelength range, there will high hindrance due to the atmospheric particles. So currently, I'm not saying about the future, but currently polarimetry and interferometry is not possible or not applicable with LIDAR and optical multispectral remote sensing techniques. But if you will see synthetic aperture radar, so here we are using the wavelength ranges in centimeters, like starting from 2 centimeter or 1 millimeter to 100 centimeters. So wavelength range or wavelength is very, very large in comparison to the atmospheric dust particle or cloud, so that polarimetry and interferometry could be easily implemented. Now, when we are talking about the multispectral, optical multispectral, as well as the LIDAR, so visible and near infrared, when we are going to talk about, so visible range is basically 0.4 micrometer to 0.7 micrometer. And infrared range, near reflected infrared range will be 0.7 micrometer to 3 micrometer. So this wavelength range is very, very small in comparison to the atmospheric dust particle as well as the cloud particle. So there will be complete blockage due to the atmospheric dust particle and the cloud particle if there will be haze or cloud in the atmosphere. So when there will be cloud, so LIDAR and optical multispectral, they are not going to provide good information, because entire information will be completely blocked by the cloud cover. Like in the case of cloudy situation, we can see that we are not able to see the sun's radiation. Sun will not be visible. So what will happen in that area or in that region? The entire information of the sun's illumination will be blocked by the cloud cover. So no information will be coming back, or coming or no information will be going towards the sensor. So at that time, imaging could not be done. So one will not be able to get any information of the earth surface, particularly this time period. If you will see this season, rainy season, so for in the rainy season to do any mapping and monitoring, like flood mapping or monitoring, or agricultural mapping and monitoring, one will require the data set of the earth surface. But at that time, the optical multispectral or any other sensor, due to their small wavelength ranges, are not going to provide any helpful information. That time, the agencies, the researchers, as well as all the people involved in the mapping and monitoring, they are going to use the microwave data set or SAR data set, because SAR data set will penetrate the cloud cover and it will interact with the earth object, and it is going to provide the complete information of the earth surface. So particularly in the case of flood mapping and monitoring, or in the case of rice crop mapping and monitoring, agencies are mainly using the synthetic aperture radar data set. And if you will see the acquisition time, so the LIDAR and SAR both are examples of active remote sensing techniques. Both will have their own radiation. They are not going to be affected by sun's illumination or sun's reflected light. So in the daytime as well as in the nighttime, in the, both the time period, they are capable to provide the same information. So they will have the night vision capability also. It means that SAR sensors and LIDAR sensors both could be operated in night time. If you will see a number of SAR satellites, so actual number is very large. I have listed here the few satellites. So we are going to start with RISAT-1. So RISAT-1 was launched in April 2012. Currently this satellite is not working, but the archive data set is available. So this satellite was launched in C band, and the mean wavelength range was approximately 5.5 to 5.6 centimeter, and the frequency was also similar, 5.6 gigahertz. Now, when we are talking about radar set 1 and radar set 2 and the radar set constellation mission, so radar set is the series of Canadian Space Agency. So this satellite was also launched in C band. Currently, radar set 1. Is not available, is not working, but its archive data set is available for the users. Radar set 2 is working. It was launched in 2007. but still after the 13 years of their of its launch, it is providing successfully the data set for the entire globe, but one will have to pay the money to get the data set of RADARSAT-2, because RADARSAT-2 data set as well as the LOS data, Terras RX data, these data sets are not freely available to all the users. Similarly, if you will come to the series ERS-1, ERS-2, INVSAT, and Sentinel-1A and Sentinel-1B, these were the satellites launched by ESA, European Space Agency. So ERS-1 and ERS-2, both were the tandem satellites, and ERS-1 was launched in 1991, ERS-2 was launched in 1995. And they these two satellites have been widely used for the scientific applications as well as the technology development. And JERS, ELOS, and ELOS-2, these are the series from Japanese Space Research Center, JAXA. So these satellites were launched in L-band, and the mean wavelength range is approximately 23 centimeters. So these satellites have been widely used for forest cover mapping and monitoring, because these satellites or L-band will have the capability to penetrate the top canopy surface, and it will interact with the branches as well as the stem of the tree, and it will provide the valuable information regarding the structure of tree, and that valuable information is related with the forest parameters and height as well as the biomass and the stem volume. Different forest parameters have been estimated with the help of the satellite successfully. And when we are coming to very high resolution satellites, so Terras RX and Tandem X, these two satellites are providing the data set in X band, and the Terras RX was launched in 2007 and Tandem X was launched in 2010. These are twin satellites, their configuration is same. So that they both have been operated in different imaging mode, different type of scientific work has been done regarding its imaging mode data format as well as in the different applications and using the technology development as well as the model development. Again, coming to the Sentinel-1A and Sentinel-1B, so these were the satellites which were launched after INVSAT, because INVSAT was launched in 2012 and it had stopped working I think in 2010-11, if I'm not forgetting. But get the continuous data set in C-band, Sentinel-1A was launched in 2014 and Sentinel-1B was launched in 2016. And one very good thing with these two satellites is the data set. The data set of these two satellites are freely available to all the users for the entire globe, and several people including researchers as well as the government agencies, private agencies for any kind of mapping and monitoring, including disaster mapping, they are widely using the Sentinel-1A and 1B data set, because the data set is not only available for the entire globe, but temporal data set at 6 days, 12 days interval is provided by the ESA, so that people can do the continuous mapping and monitoring of their study area. And if you will see, there are several kind of applications for different frequency ranges. If you will see, so we are going to start with P-band. So P-band frequency range will be in between 43.2 to 438 megahertz. And wavelength 43.8 megahertz. Generally, wavelength is kept in between 70 centimeter, near to 70 centimeter. So here 68.5 to 69.4 centimeter wavelength. And currently, we have the only one space-borne SAR mission which is planned for future, and that mission is biomass. So it is expected that biomass will be launched in next few years. And it is going to provide the data set for the Earth surface, and we are expecting that due to the very long wavelength range, it will have the very high penetration capability, and it could be used for the mapping and monitoring of the tropical and the dense forest area. And due to the penetration capability. It can penetrate the earth surface also, and it can provide the subsurface information, so it may be used for the archaeological applications also. Now, since P-band is data set is not available, so several scientific work has been used with the help of L-band data set, because it has also the good penetration capability. So for forest mapping and monitoring, agriculture, geological, hydrological mapping and monitoring, it has been widely used. And if you'll see, the first sensor was CSAT, and the future sensor which is planned is NISR L-band as well as the tandem L-band. And other missions like JERS-1, ALOS, ALOS Pulsar and ALOS 2 Pulsar 2 and SAOCOM, these were launched, and they are already providing the data set. Basically, ALOS Pulsar is providing the data set in different imaging modes, so it has been widely used. Now, if you see S-band data set, so S-band has been less explored because this data set is not easily available. But like NOAA-SAR 1 is providing the data set, but again, the limitation is the limitation with the user will be the availability of the fund, because one will have to order the data set of the NOAA-SAR, then only they are going to provide. Otherwise, after the launch of NISAR, we will have the data set in S-band also, because NISAR is basically NASA ISRO Synthetic Aperture Radar mission. So in this mission, this will be the first mission in the world in which 12 frequency SAR system will be launched in the space, and the two frequency ranges are L-band and S-band. So the data set will be acquired in L-band and S-band, and it is expected that the data set will be freely available to all the users for the entire globe. And this data set, set could be used for ship detection, ice mapping and monitoring, oil spill detection, flood mapping, forest mapping and monitoring, and crop classification also. Now, when we are talking about the C-band, so approximately 5.4 gigahertz is used for the mapping and monitoring. So if you'll see, the series of satellites have been launched, ERS-1 and 2, InVSAT SR, Radar Set 1 and 2, Radar Set Constellation Mission, that is RCM, RI Set 1 and 1A, 1A is planned for the future, and the Sentinel 1A and 1B, these missions have been successfully launched, and their data set have been widely used. And this has the C-band will have the sensitivity with the crop, not with the very long crop, but it has the sensitivity with the small size crops like paddy crop, as well as the sensitivity to the grasses, and it has the sensitivity to the ocean features, and it has been widely used for the oil spill detection as well as the ship detection. It is expected that this data set could also be explored, because several scientists, they have worked for glacier mapping and monitoring as well as height estimation of the trees also, so one can explore in the different fields. Now, X-band data set, when we are going to see, so number of satellites have been launched, like TerraSAR-X, TandemX, Cosmo SkyMed, IGS, TechSAR, RISAT-2, PAS, COMSAT-5, SAR-Loop, ICI Constellation. So these satellites are designed in X-band, and the data set has the sensitivity to the surface reference, and it has the capability to provide the very high spatial resolution data set. Like when we are talking about TerraSAR-X and TandemX, so both the satellites, they may be operated in different imaging modes, but there is one particular mode, that is the staring spotlight mode. So when TerraSAR-X or TandemX will be operated in staring spotlight mode, so it can provide the data set with the resolution of 25 centimeter, very, very high resolution data set, but the coverage will become small. So this data set could be used for a small object detection also. Now, when we are talking about the plan of Indian SAR Earth Observation Satellites, so RISAT-2 was launched in 2009, but this data set is not freely available to all the users. RISAT-1 was launched in 2012, and this data set is freely available to all the users. RISAT-2B was launched in 2019, and X-band data set is available. And RISAT-2B, R1 was also launched, but these two data sets are not freely available to all the users, like for for general users, these data sets are not available. RISET-1A, which is launched to be launched, which is scheduled to be launched in this year. So it is expected that this C-band data set will be available for all the users, so one can order the data set after the launch. Now, when we are talking about NISR mission, so again, the entire world is looking for this mission because, as we have already discussed, this is the unique mission, and this will be the first mission in which we are going to do the Earth observation in L-band and S-band, because ISRO has already launched Chandrayaan-2 mission in L-band and S-band dual frequency mode. So that mission we have already launched, but for Earth observation, NISR will be the first mission. And this data set will be freely available to all the users. Now, when we are talking about, we have some introduction to synthetic aperture radar remote sensing. Now, suppose one is interested and suppose one is thinking that, what is the need of SAR data set? Why do you need SAR data set? So here, there are two data sets. The left-hand side data set is optical multispectral false color composite image. That image is generated from LIS-4 sensor of ISRO. And the right-hand side image is again false color composite image, which is generated from RISAT-1, Radar Imaging Satellite 1 for ISRO. And the data set was acquired in hybrid pole mode. There is one special mode, so the data set was acquired in this mode. Now, if you will see for the visualization point of view, from the first view, one will think that optical multispectral data set is going to provide the very good information. Because in the image, if you will see, the data set were acquired in the image of false color composite is generated with the help of infrared band, red band, and the green band. And infrared band is represented by red color, and red band is represented by green color, and green band is represented by blue color. Now what we are going to see, since vegetation has very high reflection or very high sensitivity, and it is going to reflect very high amount of amount of electromagnetic wave in infrared range of electromagnetic spectrum. So entire vegetation is represented here as red color. So in the left-hand side image of the LIS-4 false color composite, so the red color is basically representing the vegetation. And if you will see the other features like dry river bed and the urban area, both are represented, highlighted in the cyan color. And if you will see the water body, the water of the holy river Ganga, if you will see, that is also visible in the image, that is represented in blue color here. Okay, so different features are available and we are easily able to recognize those features. So for the visual image interpretation, at a first look, one can say that, okay, this data set will have very good sensitivity, and this has a very high sensitivity. Because forest ranges, forest cover, and agriculture patches, because agriculture patches, one can see the pink color patches. Those are the agriculture patches, and those are visible in the image. And this image is very good. Why did this image is appearing very good for the visual image interpretation? Because our eyes are sensitive, or our eyes are mainly working in the visible range of electromagnetic spectrum, that is 0.4 micrometer to 0.7 micrometer. And here, since our eyes are not sensitive for the infrared, so but the sensors are capable to get the data set infrared, so infrared data set is also used to do the imaging. So anyhow, this data set, optical multispectral data set, is going to appear very good for the visual image interpretation. No one can replace. And if you will see the same data set in the false color composite of the image of the RISAT-1 data set, so here water and the barren surfaces, or the plain surfaces, they are like, if you see this river bed and the roads, they are going to appear as very, very dark feature. Because what is happening, when the SAR sensor is transmitting electromagnetic pulses, and when those electromagnetic pulses with interact with the ground surface, and suppose that is water body or very smooth surface is there, like road or barren land, so what will happen? There will be perfect reflection of the microwave from those surfaces. So the electromagnetic wave, which is incident on these type of features, will be reflected away from the direction of the SAR sensor. So SAR sensor is going to receive very less energy or very less back scattered energy for these type of objects. So SAR sensor is going to sense them as a very dark feature, because very less information will be there. And like targets like urban buildings, they are going to give very high scattering or very high scattered energy will be received by the sensor. So those features are going to appear as very bright feature, and forest canopy or vegetation is going to appear as the moderate feature. But anyhow, we are able to get this information. But SAR sensor, as we have already talked, the optical multispectral is going to appear as very good, because it is working in the optical multispectral range as well as near infrared. Microwave data set is working in the microwave range of electromagnetic spectrum. One basic difference with these two data sets, here if you will see, optical multispectral data set is mainly sensitive to the top color information of the object. This is not sensitive to the any other property. This is mainly sensitive to the color information of the object. Obviously, there will be sensitivity to the texture and the other property also, but mainly very high sensitivity is there due to the top color information. Now, SAR data set is not sensitive to the color information, top color information of the object. So whatever the color will be there of the object, like suppose in a true color composite image, or in the suppose we are using green band, so in the green band image, the green color building as well as the vegetation canopy, both are going to appear as, please mute your mic. Hello.
Request to participants, please mute your mic.
Thank you. Now, if you will see, so it has not sensitivity to the color information. Microwave will not have sensitivity to the color. It will be sensitive to the object structural property as well as the electrical property. Like if we are going to the green band of the if you are doing the imaging in the green band, and suppose there is a green color building as well as a vegetation, so vegetation canopy will also have the green color. So vegetation as well as the green color building, both will be highlighted in the green band. So sensor will not be able to distinguish both the objects, because both will appear as green color. So on the basis of color, that sensor will not be able to distinguish. But there are different other parameters like shape, size. So based on that parameter, one will be able to differentiate. But when we are going to use the microwave data set, both will be distinguished as two different features, because both will have different scattering property, because both will have the different geometric property, different structural property. So based on that, one will be able to get. Now we are going to see that how SAR sensor is retrieving extra information of using these characteristics. So in the next PPT, I think this is visible to you. The top image is one band of LIS-4 that is represented at the gray scale, because each band will be represented at gray scale. We have the flexibility to represent it at the color information also, but generally or obviously that will be grayscale in between the according to the radiometric property. So top one is representing the LIS-4 data set, and the second one is representing SAR data set. So this slide is going to show a comparison between microwave and optical data, and as we have already talked, optical and microwave data both are both have the different sensitivity, because optical multispectral will be sensitive to the color information. How we are going to see here, like if you will see, just see the lower side of the image. In the river, we are going to get a channel. So in that channel, if you will see, in the river channel, at the bottom, if you will see, in the second image, we are going to get a bright line. That bright linear feature is visible. And if you will see the same linear feature in the top image, so that linear feature is not available. Basically, from our image interpretation skill, one can say that, like in the optical data set, however, this object is not visible, but from our image interpretation skill, one can say that there is a barrage because water is diverted from the mainstream. It means that there is some object or there is some kind of construction which is diverting the water. That is basically barrage. Now, if you will see the color information of that barrage, so obviously the color information of barrage is merging with the background water, and due to the merge of the color information, because the barrage is having the same color of the water, it means that will have the that barrage will have the color in blue as well as the green. So due to that property, entire barrage has been hidden here. That barrage is not visible. But if you will see the microwave data set, as we have talked, that microwave data set is not sensitive to the color information. It has the sensitivity to the structural property as well as the electrical property. So the barrage, the material of barrage, or the material which is used to build the barrage, will be concrete material as well as the iron. So iron and the concrete both will have the entirely different dielectric property as well as the structural property in comparison to the background water. So barrage is clearly distinguished at different feature than the background water. So one advantage what we are going to get, that the SAR sensor is not sensitive to the color information. It has sensitivity to the structural as well as the electrical property of the object. So one will be able to get that information, or the information which is not clearly visible in the optical multispectral data set. So one advantage we have seen. Now the second advantage we have to see, just see the undulating terrain information. If you will see the undulating terrain information or undulating feature in the top image basically resource set 2 LIS4 data set, and the bottom one is the RI set 1 FRS 1. So the both the subset were taken from the big imagery which we have seen in the last slide. So if you see the undulating terrain and the river beds, which are clearly visible in the last image, the second image, if you will see the river channels as well as the undulating terrain is clearly visible. It means that complete topography of the earth surface is visible in the SAR data set, because this data set was acquired at C-band, and C-band will have the higher sensitivity to the structure, as well as it can penetrate some kind of small grasses. So it will be able to interact with the earth surface and it will be able to provide the topographic information. Now the same information in the top image is not visible. Even the river channels are also not clearly visible. All the river channels are also not clearly visible. Both the satellites are having approximately same resolution, because like when RI set 1 was operated in FRS 1 mode, so after doing multi-looking and different operations, so its resolution was also approximately 5.4 to 5.6 meter, and the LIS4 was also having the same resolution. But with the same resolution, we are going to get extra information in the SAR data set. There are other features, like one more barrage is also there in the river body. The big patch of water, if you will see, so there the water is diverted with the help of the barrage. So here that information also is well. So we are going to get the complete information, like first of all, the sensitivity due to the structural property. So we are able to identify the objects which are having the similar color. So those objects could be distinguished or discriminated with the help of their dielectric as well as the structural property, because this is SAR data set is not sensitive to the color information. Now the second is complete topographic information could be retrieved if one is interested to retrieve the topography. So complete topography information could be retrieved from the SAR data set. So the digital elevation model, which is generated for the, to find out the elevation model of the elevation of the earth surface. So digital elevation model generated from SAR data set has high reliability in comparison to any other data set, in comparison to particularly optical multispectral data set. But LIDAR data set, since this is going to provide you very, very high spatial resolution, so this will also have very high accuracy in the elevation model. But since space-borne SAR sensors, high-resolution space-borne SAR sensors could be acquired, could be operated to acquire the data set for large area, so a very accurate digital elevation model could be generated for a large area. Now, the second image, we have seen the sensitivity to the structural property and sensitivity to retrieve the topographic information that we have already seen. Now, we are going to see the another image for the Sahara Desert. So if you will see this image, so this is Sahara Desert. The top image is the completely optical multispectral data set, and you can see that in the entire area we are going to see the golden sand, and that could be easily seen. Now if you will see the middle strip the in the second image at the bottom side, in the second image, if you will see, the middle strip was acquired by Shuttle Imaging Radar, SAR-A mission, because Shuttle Imaging Radar mission was operated to generate high resolution image of the entire globe. So SRTM-DM has been generated for entire Earth surface. So that data set is freely available to all the users, 90 meter and 30 meter also data set is available for all the users. So one can download that digital elevation model, and they can use for their own application for their study area. Now here what we are going to see, so the penetration capability, so SAR-A, Shuttle Imaging Radar A, was operated in L-band. So if you see the middle strip, which was acquired by the optical multispectral, so optical multispectral, in the optical multispectral image, so the middle strip is appearing completely smooth. Completely smooth means this is showing that the surface is completely smooth, the complete desert is there, there is no deviation. So we are not going to get very much in, means any other information other than the sand. But if you will see in the SAR image, we are not going to get only the sand information. We are going to get some other type of features. Basically, we are going to get the subsurface information of the feature, because L-band synthetic aperture radar that has penetrated the top surface of the sand, and it interacted with the subsurface, and the subsurface features could be detected with the help of L-band, and here it was detected, and finally paleo channels were detected, and here what we are getting, what we are going to get, the paleo channels, and it is showing that like the in the past there was presence of water. And because if channels are there, water channels are there, water channels were there in the past, it means that the vegetation and the other features were also there near to the surface. So this data set is also used, and this has been widely used for the archaeological applications, long wavelength data set L-band. But to get very high penetration, people are also using ground penetrating radars. And now we are going to see the synthetic aperture radar geometry. Okay, so as we have already talked, like the first image is the if you'll see the first image, so the bottom one is representing the different features of the earth surface, and SAR data set is SAR sensor is operated to acquire the data set for that area, and the data set was acquired, and we are knowing that this data set is not sensitive to the color. So the data set will be having the information according to their scattering property, and scattering property is basically depending on the structural property as well as the dielectric behavior of the object or the electrical property of the object. So accordingly, they have been imaged, or the imaged according to the backscatter information. Now, if you will see in the image of the SAR sensor, which is shown here, this is basically taken from the a book of remote sensing, basically written by Dr. J.R. Jensen. So, in this image, this is airborne. This is an example or graphical representation of airborne synthetic aperture radar remote sensing. So, in the airborne synthetic aperture radar remote sensing technique, here you can see the SAR sensor is visible in one linear direction. Is moving in one direction, and that is clearly visible. That direction is known as the azimuth direction or flight direction. So, flight direction is the azimuth direction or the direction in which SAR sensor is moving. And there is one more direction is represented here by another arrow, and it is written as range or look direction. So here SAR sensor is transmitting the electromagnetic pulses in range or look direction. So one area will be illuminated, and if you will see one area, so excuse me, my screen is visible to you still. Hello,
sir.
To you?
Yes, sir. It is visible.
Okay. Thank you. Here you can see that near range and far range is there. So one nadir point. Another point is the point which is sorry, I am getting disturbance. Okay, no noise. Nadir point is the vertical line, nadir line with the vertical line which is joining the earth surface to the aircraft. That will be the line, and area illuminated area which will be appearing near to the nadir point will be known as near range, and the area which will be appearing away from the nadir will be known as the far range. So the data set will be captured in between near range and far range. These geometrical parameters are important because when we are processing the SAR data set, so these geometrical parameters are used, particularly angle of incidence. So here angle of incidence is represented as theta, and angle of incidence will be varying from near range to far range. For near range, so angle of incidence is represented by theta n. So here what we are going to get, so I according to definition, the angle of incidence is the angle between incident electromagnetic wave and a normal which is drawn perpendicular in a perpendicular direction to the point of contact. So this angle will be the angle of incidence, and this is playing very important role when we are going to retrieve back scattered cross section of any object. And here we have already seen there are two directions in the case of SAR remote sensing technique. One is azimuth direction, another is range direction. Now due to these two directions, generally in any remote sensing technique there will be only one spatial resolution, but in SAR remote sensing there are two resolutions due to two directions. Because as we have seen, there are two directions. One is azimuth direction, the direction in which SAR sensor is moving. Another is range direction, the direction in which SAR sensor is transmitting electromagnetic pulses. So azimuth direction is having the azimuth resolution, or we can say that azimuth resolution is the length of resolution cell in the azimuth direction, and range resolution is the length of resolution cell in the range direction. Now here there is a better visualization of both the resolution. The here purple color arrow is representing azimuth resolution, and green color is representing range resolution. So in one resolution there will be two spatial resolutions, azimuth resolution and range resolution. Now when we are talking about azimuth resolution, so azimuth resolution is directly depending on the antenna length. Actually, one may ask that when the radar sensor is used to transmit the electromagnetic pulses, then what is the requirement of synthetic aperture radar? So synthetic aperture radar is basically used to generate high spatial resolution. Now if you see, there are two resolutions, azimuth resolution and range resolution. So azimuth resolution is directly depending on the antenna size. Longer the antenna, higher will be the azimuth resolution. R0 is representing range direction, the direction from sensor to the target. So in the case of spaceborne SAR remote sensing, this will be sometimes 400 to 800 or 900 kilometers. Lambda is the used wavelength, and L is representing antenna length. Now if you will see the actual antenna length, so that will be a few meters, 20 meter or 30 meter. It will not be possible to generate very high spatial azimuth resolution from this small antenna. So scientists utilize the velocity of the spacecraft to synthesize a long antenna from the small antenna. Here you can see in this slide, one point target is visible here. So for that point, yes, any question? So for that point target, when the SAR sensor is operated, so suppose the sensor is able to capture the information from the first mode, it will be operated to acquire the data set from different locations within their visibility length. After this visibility length, the point target will not be visible to the sensor. So the entire information from first time to the last time will be merged, and the total traveled or total length which is traveled by the SAR sensor in the azimuth direction will behave like a very large antenna. So by merging all the information or all the return signal, the one will be able to generate very high spatial resolution. Now the second resolution is range resolution is not directly depending on the antenna length. It is basically depending on the pulse width. Then the formula is given, C tau divided by 2. C is velocity of the electromagnetic wave, and tau is the pulse width. So here this is one example shown here. For tau if the tau is 1 microsecond, so if tau is 1 microsecond, so when we will multiply it with the speed of light, so it will become approximately 300 meter. So 300 meter means, according to the formula, range resolution, C tau divided by 2. So 300 divided by 2 means 150 meter. So for 150 meter range resolution, suppose there are two objects. So here in the first, in the top one, in the top image, you can see that the two objects, their distance is less than 100 meter or less than 150 meter. So what is happening? If the distance is only 100 meters, so both the objects will be detected as one object, because sensor will not be able to distinguish these two objects as two separate objects, because their distance is very less. Now in the second image, or in the second example at the bottom, if you see, the space is 200 meter. So due to this space, is since here space is 200 meter, so with tau equals to 1 microsecond, again range resolution is 150 meter, and the distance is greater than the wavelength, the distance is greater than the range resolution. So finally both the objects will be appeared as two different objects, and they will be placed in two different resolution cells in the SAR imagery. Now when we are talking about the SAR imagery, since the SAR images are side looking radar systems, so in side looking radar system, due to the side looking geometry, the objects appearing in near range, here one can see that A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H is the ground range information, graphical representation of the ground range object, and the A dash, B dash, C dash is representing, the top one is representing the slant range image acquired by the SAR sensor. So here what we are getting, the objects appearing in near range, they are compressed in their shape and size, and due to this compression, if one will have the SAR data set which is having slant range ambiguity, so the first task should be to minimize ambiguity of the slant range. Now polarization is playing very important role, because the electromagnetic waves used to do the imaging is polarized electromagnetic wave, because unpolarized electromagnetic wave will vibrate, or one can say that the electric field vector of unpolarized energy or electromagnetic wave will be vibrate in all the possible directions, and in the return signal also this will be vibrating in all the possible directions. So there will complete noise in the image. Now SAR sensor is going to transmit the polarized electromagnetic pulses and the polarization will be vertical or horizontal according to the direction of propagation of electromagnetic wave. Now in the next slide here, we are going to see the different polarimetric combinations of the star data set. So basically four polarimetric combinations are used: HH, HB, VH and VB. So HH is representing horizontally polarized electromagnetic wave is transmitted and horizontally polarized electromagnetic wave is received. HB is representing horizontally polarized electromagnetic wave is transmitted, vertically is received, and simply what VH is representing vertical transmission and horizontal receive, and VB is representing vertically transmitted electromagnetic waves were transmitted and vertically were received. Now if a SAR sensor is capable to provide only one polarimetric combination, either HH, HB, VH or VB during imaging, then the data set will be known as single pole data set or single polarized data set. If the sensor is capable to provide any two polarization during imaging out of the four polarimetric combinations, then that data set will be known as a dual polarized data set or dual polarimetric data set. And if the sensor is capable to provide all the four polarimetric channels, then the data set will be known as a quad pole data set. Now when we are talking about the SAR data set, so SAR data set consists of high resolution reflected returns of radar frequency energy from the terrain that has been illuminated by a direct beam of a pulse generated by the sensor. The radar returns from the terrain are mainly determined by the physical characteristics of the surface, such as the surface roughness, geometric structure and orientation, and the electrical characteristic, that is the dielectric constant, moisture content and conductivity, and the radar frequency of the sensor. Now if you will see in the image, it is a very high resolution image of the TerraSAR X Visakhapatnam. So here one can easily see the data set was acquired for the Visakhapatnam port. So in the image, the ships are also clearly visible, ships as well as the playground and ropes. All the features are clearly visible, and when you will zoom it, you are going to get the clear view of the object. This is the JPEG file generated from the main imagery. So water body is completely. Hello, please mute your mics. I think someone has not muted his mic, so there is disturbance. So please mute your mic. So here you can see that in TerraSAR X Visakhapatnam image, one will be able to find the different objects. Now we are going to see some principles, like there is a relationship between wavelength, depression angle, as well as the height of the object. Because we are going to talk about the surface roughness, because SAR sensor is used to find out the roughness, surface roughness also. So there is very famous criteria which was given by the Rayleigh, that is the Rayleigh criteria. According to that criteria, if the height of the object is less than the wavelength divided by 8 sine depression angle, then that surface will be known as the smooth surface. And if the object height is greater than this quantity, lambda divided by 8 sine gamma, then that surface will be known as the rough surface. But this was not working well in all the conditions. So again, this criteria was modified by Peake and Oliver, and this is known as the modified Rayleigh criteria. And according to that criteria, if object height is less than lambda divided by 25 sine gamma, where gamma is angle of depression and lambda is wavelength, then the surface will be known as a smooth surface. And if the object height is greater than lambda divided by 4.4 sine gamma, then the object will be, sorry, then the surface will be rough surface. And if the object height will be in between these two relations, then the surface will be intermediate surface, intermediate rough surface. Now what important point I want to show you is the relation between the wavelength as well as the SAR geometric parameter and the object height. Like if you see the example, so the object object height 0.276 centimeter will behave as a rough surface for aircraft KA band. For aircraft KA band, here the wavelength is 0.86 centimeter and the gamma is 45 degree, angle of depression 45 degree. So here what we are getting, that if the object height will be greater than 0.276, it means that the surface is going to appear as rough surface. Now the same surface, suppose 0.276 or suppose 0.5 centimeter object height surface, is there. And again, if we are going to use CSAT L band data set for the same area or any L band data set which will be having this configuration, 23.5 centimeter wavelength with depression angle 70 degree, so the same surface is going to appear as a smooth surface, because here the smooth surface criteria is if all the surfaces which will be having object height less than 1 centimeter is going to appear as a smooth surface. It means that one surface which is going to appear as rough surface for one data set, it might be possible that the same surface is going to appear as a smooth surface of another SAR sensor or another SAR data set. Now we are going to see the angle of incidence. We have already talked about what is the sensitivity in the back scatter due to the angle of incidence. Here what we are going to see that the SAR sensor antenna is there, and SAR sensor is transmitting the electromagnetic pulses, and electromagnetic pulses are interacting with the earth object. So what we are going to get, if you will see here, so when the angle of incidence is large, very high, so generally in far range angle of incidence will be large. So in the large angle of incidence, so there will be, if the surface is smooth, there will be very high reflection and more energy will be reflecting away from the sensor. Sensor will get very less energy. Now in the case of low angle of incident data set, in the case of low angle of incidence, here one can see that near to the nadir, here it is representing the low angle of incidence data set, so very high amount will be received by the sensor. Now similarly for the rough surface also, the similar phenomena will happen. If that is continuously rough surface from near range to far range, so more energy will be received by the sensor for the objects which are appearing in the near range, and less energy will be received for the similar object in the far range. Now that is the angle of incidence we have seen, because angle of incidence is directly could be measured according to the look angle of incidence or look angle. And generally SAR sensors by default they are providing the look angle, and that look angle is converted into the angle of incidence. But the look angle based angle of incidence which is provided by the SAR sensor is not always used to characterize the scattering based property retrieval of, or scattering based parameter retrieval of the terrain or the object. Here one can see that one mountainous terrain is there or hilly terrain is there. Now for if you see for the hilly terrain, the since the terrain is undulating, so to get the actual angle of incidence information, one will be in need of external digital elevation model, because external elevation model only can provide the slope information, and that slope will be used to find out the local angle of incidence, and that local incidence angle will be used to find the actual radar cross section from the image. Now we are going to see the interaction of electromagnetic wave with soil. So there are three type of soil we are going to see here: dry soil, wet soil, and the flooded soil. So in the case of dry soil, penetration will be very high and scattering will be less. So dry soil is going to appear as dark surface. In the case of wet soil, penetration will be less, scattering will be high. So when the scattering will be high, more energy will be received by the sensor. So wet soil is going to appear as bright feature. When we compare with the dry and wet soil, so dry will appear dark and the wet will appear bright. Now in the case of flooded soil, if the entire surface of the soil will be completely covered by the water body or flooded by the water, so there will be complete reflection. You can see that there is no scattering, so entire information will be going away from the direction of the sensor. So these type of features are going to appear as very dark surface or very dark feature. One very important parameter, that is the volume scattering. Volume scattering is the name given, like entire volume of the feature is going to contribute in the scattering. So here mainly when we are talking about the vegetation, so in the vegetation, entire structure of the vegetation, like the top vegetation cover, tree leaves, as well as small twigs, then branches, as well as the big branches, then the stem, so all are contributing in the scattering. Because when the electromagnetic energy will incident, the transmitter electromagnetic will incident from the tree leaf, incident on the tree leaf, first interaction will be there from the tree leaf, then again it will penetrate through the tree leaves, if it will be giving the canopy gap, or it will have the long wavelength, so it will penetrate and it will go to the small twigs, then branches, then big branches. So finally, the entire volume of the forest or the tree will be contributing in the scattering. So this will be known as the volume scattering. And this is the representation of graphical representation of incoming radiation in L band, C band, and X band. Here one can see that in L band, the very high amount of return signal will be received by the sensor, because it will penetrate from the top canopy cover and it will interact with the branches, then the big branches, then the stem, as well as the ground. But in the case of C band, since the wavelength is 5.8 centimeter, very less penetration will be there. So mainly it will be interacting with the top canopy cover and some small branches. And in the case of X band, very small wavelength, 3 centimeter. So all the information, because most of the tree leaves are having the tree leaf size longer than the 3 centimeter, so most of the energy will be blocked by the top canopy cover. So most of the energy will be retained. Most of the energy will be returned from the surface only. Now, when we are talking about the SAR data set, so each and every resolution of the SAR data set is represented by a complex number, because the resolution cell of the SAR data set is representing the phase of electromagnetic wave at the time of interaction with the particular target. So one pixel or one resolution cell is representing phase of electromagnetic wave at the time of interaction with the particular target. And now we know that electromagnetic waves are always represented in complex numbers. So here, to find out the phase and amplitude information at different time periods in the imagery for different locations, so complex numbers are used, because if these numbers will be there, so one will be able to find out the phase as well as the amplitude information. So each and every resolution cell will have the will be represented in the complex number. One will be the real channel, another will be the imaginary channel. Now, one big problem in SAR data set is the speckle effect. A SAR resolution cell generally contains a large number of scatters, and due to unexpected brightness, sometimes what is happening, due to the scattering or due to the constructive and destructive scattering in the return signal from the homogeneously smooth or homogeneously rough surface, we are going to get a very high constructive and the destructive interference, and those are going to appear as bright and dark patches. So dark patches, it is difficult to identify, but there are several techniques to identify those patches also. But bright patches could be easily identified. In the next slide, we are going to see, like in the top image, if you will see, again, this is the image for the Visakhapatnam. Like, we are expecting that from the water body, there will be very smooth scattering, and there will be only darkness, because that surface is perfectly smooth and particularly this is water, so this will be completely dark. But we are not going to get the complete darkness here. We are getting several white patches and white dots in the water body. Basically, that is the speckle. Like when there will be some kind of scattering in the return signal, constructive scattering is occurring, because that is homogeneously smooth. So here one can easily identify there is a speckle effect. A speckle effect is very difficult to identify or difficult to get from urban area, because in urban area we are expecting that high scattering, and in that high scattering, if there will be any bright noise, so it is really difficult. But from the water body, we can easily identify if we are getting speckle effect in the water body, the bright patches we are getting, bright dots we are getting. So there is a requirement of speckle filtering. So there are different speckle filters. Most of the speckle filters are the low pass filters, but some are adaptive pass filters also. So there are several filters. So by using the speckle filtering, now the second image, one can see that now the bottom image is completely appearing as dark. The water body is completely appearing as dark. So this could be used. Now, we have already seen this slide, and we are going to talk about the distortion. So basically, there are three distortions: foreshortening, layover, and the shadow. So first we are going to talk about the foreshortening. Here in the image, if you will see, when the radar beam reaches the base of a tall feature tilted towards the radar, before it reaches the top, foreshortening will occur. Actually, it is really difficult to differentiate and distinguish foreshortening and layover in the SAR imagery, but there are certain things from which we can distinguish. Like in foreshortening, some amount of slope will be there, but slope, complete information of slope of undulating terrain will not be there. But in the case of layover, we are not going to get any information of the slope. Like here, entire bottom will be completely layovered by the top, so that slope will be completely not visible. Like here in this image, if you will see the slope, so here the slope is clearly not visible. So this will be known as the layover. Like if the undulating terrains are there, suppose any hilly terrain is there. If that hilly terrain will occur in near range or near to the nadi, so that hilly terrain, it is there is very high possibility that that hilly terrain is going to give layover effect, because the entire slope, slope will be covered by the top of the hilly terrain, and bottom will also not visible, and the top and the slope will not be visible. But if the same terrain will be appearing in the far range, means away from the nadir point, so that is going to give you the foreshortening effect. Some information of the slope will be visible, but that complete information will not be visible. So these are the distortions. People are using the multi-passes, from multiple passes, ascending, descending from different angle of incidences to overcome this problem. But to complete overcome is really very difficult. And shadow is the effect when like in the case of layover, foreshortening, or any object which will be blocking the electromagnetic radiation, so just opposite side we are going to get shadow, that is known as the radar shadow. Also here, like dark patches are representing radar shadow. Now then we are going to get the polarimetric radar. So in tomorrow lecture we are going in some detail, but just for your information, polarimetric radars, they at the same time the sensor is capable to provide the four polarimetric channels, HH, SV, VH and VV. So those channels are used to do the imaging, and the different images are provided. And these are the three modes to acquire the SAR data set: strip map mode, spotlight mode, and scan SAR mode. Strip map mode, moderate resolution and moderate swath. Spotlight mode, very high spatial resolution but very less swath, means coverage will be small. Total area which will be covered will be 6 km by 6 km, but resolution will be 1 meter or 25 centimeter or 50 centimeter. Now scan SAR mode, resolution will be coarse, like 50 meter, 20 meter, like that. But coverage will be very large, like the data in one scene, approximately 200 kilometer by 200 or 300 kilometer by 300 kilometer area will be covered. And there are different formats of SAR data set: raw data, SLC data, multi-loop data, geocoded data, and polarimetric data. Generally, people are not preferring to use the raw data set, because raw data set requires signal processing. So generally, space agencies are providing the data set in SLC mode and multi-loop mode also. But SLC data, SLC mode data set is widely used for the scientific application, because anyhow, when we will have the raw data set, we will have to convert the SLC data, that is basically single loop complex data set. So complex information of the SAR data set will be provided in the SLC mode data set. And finally, in this format of the data set, one will be able to do the different application. So here, this is the quad pole data set, sigma naught HS, sigma naught VV, and sigma naught HV and VH. So like this is the data set which was acquired for one area, that this is the forest area of Karnataka, and the was LOS 2, Pulsar 2. So this was operated to acquire the data set. Here one can see that the features, like if you see the water body, so even water body is giving different type of scattering. In both it is dark, but if you will see carefully, so even water body is giving different scattering pattern in both the polarimetric channel. Why? Because scattering, received scattering is sensitive to the used polarization also. So with the help of a polarimetric combination, different polarimetric combinations, all the four polarimetric combinations, one will be able to generate the color composite of the image. Now, like here in this color composite, the pink patches are representing the pink color, or red color is representing double bounce scattering, that is basically from the urban area. So all the urban area is represented by here by the red color patches, and smooth surfaces and the water bodies are represented by blue color. Here you can see that the water body appearing as blue color here. So, and entire forest area is represented in green color. So with the help of fully polarimetric SAR data set, one can do precise monitoring and precise mapping and monitoring, and that data set could be used for different application. Now there are like this is the second last slide. When we are talking about the advantage of SAR, which we have seen, so the cloud penetration capability to provide all weather data, night vision capability due to the active radar sensor, sensitivity of SAR sensor to structural and dielectric properties of the Earth's objects, polarimetric and interferometric phase to provide the precise target information for different applications. Now, when we are talking about the applications, so few applications I have listed, there is a very wide list of applications, like SAR, not only application, techniques also, because each and every application require a very advanced modeling technique and precise data processing technique. So here one, if you will see the SAR interferometry for digital elevation model generation, SAR interferometry for subsidence mapping and monitoring. Subsidence mapping and monitoring could be done at a millimeter level also, and SAR remote sensing for cryospheric and the glaciological application, for soil moisture content, and for structure and biophysical parameter retrieval of the forest, and crop mapping and monitoring, flood mapping and monitoring, oil spill mapping and monitoring, and ship detection. And there are several other like volcanic application. So there are different techniques possible.
Tomorrow
we will try to cover some of like how to retrieve these parameters with the help of synthetic aperture radar technique and modeling approach. Thank you. Now I am waiting for few questions from your side.